The internet is a large network that connects people to each other.
And the internet is the greatest medium for the exchange and collaboration with respect to ideas that we've ever seen.
It threatens every totalitarian regime across the world. That's why they try. That's why they block it in China.
Well, the internet is kind of this huge shared resource, right? So if I could put that in the cloud, let's say, because no one really owns it.
Here, let me show you. Your computer connects to a modem. The modem is connected to your phone or cable cord. And that cord goes to the street.
All those iron pipes that you see that cross Fulton Street have telephone cable inside them. Various different kinds of cable, copper, fiber optic. They're all contained within those iron ducts that cross the street. What it is Empire City Subway was formed in the late 1800s. I believe it was actually the blizzard of 1888 when, if you remember seeing old pictures of the Lower East Side with all the lines, electric and telephone lines, it looked like a spider's web. That blizzard brought all that down and it caused the city to become actually totally paralyzed. After that, it was mandated that all major telephone and electric facilities have to go underground so that they're protected. Empire City Subway was then formed as the franchise for New York City. So we own and maintain all the telecommunication manholes and structures meaning conduit, whether it's iron, plastic, concrete, clay, even the old wood ones. And we have tenants that rent space from us. They rent ducts. We're owned by Verizon, and Verizon is also our tenant, our biggest tenant.
We're a subterranean landlord. We lease space to our tenants, and how they occupy our space is solely entirely up to them, as long as they pay us per trench foot.
The wires travel underground to other much faster cables that carry the signal across the world. These super fast, long distance cables are often called the backbone. This building is where the internet service providers connect to that backbone.
Why is New York City so important? This is a somewhat dated diagram of the cables crossing the Atlantic, and you notice they all converge on New York City. From our cage, and I'll point out where they are, you can see the landing point for every one of these cables. All right, let's go upstairs and take a look. So now we're actually inside the Nisenet co-location space in 32 Avenue of the Americas. To our right, and this is something to look at, but you can just see pillars with lots of yellow cable wrapped around. That cable is the endpoint here of all of those lines crossing the Atlantic, of all of the carriers in the United States, of some of it crossing the Pacific.
This floor is probably the most valuable networking real estate on the planet.
Time Warner is here, Verizon is here, and to reach the sites where they start distributing to homes, they've got a backbone.
Let's talk for a minute about the difference between cable broadband and DSL broadband. And of course, cable broadband is provided by your cable company, right. And DSL broadband is provided by your phone company. And it is true that cable broadband operates across your coax cable wiring, And DSL broadband operates across your existing phone lines.
Now, a cable network was basically set up to distribute, a TV, video. And so there was a central area where they would be taking either the video off the air or off of some cable feed that came to it. And then it's distributing this out to all the neighborhoods on cables. So, you know, just like you have in your basement, you'll have the cable comes in and then there's a splitter so you can go to a couple of TVs. So in the same way, the cable would come down the street and then there'd be a splitter. And the splitter would take some down this street and some down the next street. And they keep splitting. But as you do all this splitting and as you go farther distance, the signal gets weaker. So they have to put in amplifiers. And those amplifiers boost the signal back up. Trouble is every amplifier adds a little noise. So after you've gone through a bunch of amplifiers, the noise could get to be too much. So you can, there's a limit to how much you can do of this.
The reason that the cable companies started to get into the internet is because they had coax cabling that was pretty substantial amount of bandwidth. You could travel, have a lot of data traveling along with coax cable. In fact, so much that before we had 800 channels of cable, we had, 30 or 40, and the cable companies were like, well, hey, let's use this bandwidth for something else.
But the telephone network's more complicated because what you're trying to do is connect one individual with any of the other individuals. It has to be now a much denser network and not this star topology. If you have two people, you only need one connection. If you have three people, you need three. How many do you need for four people? Well, now you need one, two, three, four, five, six, and the number starts going up very fast, the interconnected numbers. I think the telephone system, with all it's in it, must be the most complicated physical thing that humans have ever put together.
So that's how the physical wires of the internet work, but we wanted to find out about who provides internet service in New York City.
Right now in Manhattan or Brooklyn, we have almost no competition. Like in Manhattan, if you want to get internet, the only possibility are Verizon through DSL or Time Warner, Roadrunner. I guess you could buy a satellite dish or something, but I don't know how much that costs.
We went to talk to one of the only remaining independent internet service providers. That's ISPs.
We're not the only, we're one of the last remaining. There were many, many more, but it is a tough climate for small independent businesses in this business because of the regulations and the dominance, the market power of primarily the phone companies, but also the cable companies. The history of the Verizon monopoly is Ma Bell. It's the history of telecommunications. The government basically made a deal with Ma Bell about 100 years ago. You had a lot of little independent telephone companies and some of them wouldn't connect to each other as a competitive advantage. And they realized that the only way to get the real advantage of telecommunications was to have every telephone company connect to every other telephone company. So they made this grand bargain. We'll let you form what everybody said is a quote-unquote natural monopoly. Instead of having eight different phones on your desk for the eight different phone companies, we'll make it one phone company, but you can't just have a monopoly, we'll regulate it. So you had 100 years of a regulated monopoly. The 96 Telecommunication Act basically said, you baby bells, you allow anybody to plug into that network, use all the components of those networks so that people can provide competitive services. The expensive part of the telecommunications network is the wire into everybody's home. You don't want to have to run a wire and dig up the street and for every customer you're going to do in this building. So you're going to rent those pieces from Verizon, which they're obligated to under the 96 Act, and you just want to put equipment where these lines terminate so that you could then put it on your network. In our case, the way we provide broadband is we take that traffic and then we bring it out to the internet. The problem was that the enforcement of the 96 Act lagged. You get into, well, how much are they allowed to charge for it? How can you prove that it's there or not there? How fast or how slow can they do it? They basically can make it very, very difficult for that process to go on, and they did. In the days of dial-up,
Verizon was not even allowed to be in that business. Now they have 90-something percent of the DSL business.
You place a long-distance call. As you dialed, once upon a time, as you dialed, with each stroke of that dial, you'd already started to build the circuit toward your end destination, so that by it was connected, you had a dedicated circuit. And if something happened to the line in between, you went dead. With the internet protocol, the message says, wait a minute, the message stopped coming, let's find another route, and it does it by itself.
The fundamental difference between the classic telephone and the internet is that in the internet, your computer sends out packets of information.
A packet is 1,500 bytes. A byte is 8 bits. Bits are ones and zeros. They're like the on and off pulse of the computer. On the internet, everything's reduced to bits. Music, books, magazines, money, and even love, aka MySpace, Facebook. That's what we call computer love.
In the internet, messages are digitized and then broken up into little packets. Each packet has a little header on it which tells it where it's supposed to go.
It's going to go through your router, right, which it's going to convert it into a signal which can be transported. It is then going to hit the central office and basically be split off to our data network, which would then kind of pipe it up to the internet. The internet is a culmination of, I don't know if you could, if tens of thousands of routers.
And each time it reaches a router, it gets instructions about what's the next router that's on the best path for reaching that destination. And if something happens to the lines that are supporting that in between, then it goes back to the router and new instructions go to the next packets going out.
And when they get to the destination, then they all get assembled and you read out the information.
It was a Defense Department project and they were trying to define a communications protocol that could survive being attacked.
The beauty of the internet was that it wasn't a centralized broadcast system like television. It was a decentralized network that allowed anybody on the network to send a message to anybody else on the network. The thing that makes it a problem is that you only have two choices to connect to that network. It's only the phone company or the cable company. That connection is really what's going to determine how you experience the internet.
I'll show you a cool video. You're gonna like this. Hot chicks. Do they have anything like this back in your country? No. Thing takes too damn long. Only at 56K. Slow as hell. This is 56K, which is 56,000 bits of information per second. It's one of the slowest internet connections. So if you want to download a song from the Beatles hit album Yellow Submarine, it would take about 10 minutes. Now imagine sipping this cup for 10 minutes. That's 10 minutes of your life you'll never get back. With cable and DSL, you'll get a download speed of 2 million bits of information per second, which will take 14 seconds. In the town where I was born. On the other hand, fiber optics, which is 15 megabytes, you'll get a download speed of 15 million bits per second, which will only take about 3 seconds tops. My stomach.
One of the things that all of these home connections have is that they tend to be asymmetrical networks, which means that you can download a lot faster than you can upload. So you might get a 5 meg down, but only 384 kilobits up, which is your standard cable modem speeds. And so what that means is that because you can download a lot faster than you can upload, you as a consumer might be able to get stuff, but you as a producer are severely restricted in terms of the things that you can push back up and broadcast to other people.
It really is about speech. And content on the internet is your speech. And you should have the same ability to speak as you do to listen.
In case you thought that, you know, the cable modem standards were created by some third party like Wi-Fi is, and then the cable companies just happen to use them, it's not true. The cable companies come up with the standards that they all share and use themselves.
If the cable company wanted to give you a fast upload speed on your cable modem, they could. They choose not to. The network is optimized for distribution, for pushing rather than pulling.
Right.
And so they'd have to substantially change how the infrastructure is built to allow it.
They would have conflicts in distribution, conflicts and overload.
Yep. A channel could start breaking up on your TV because somebody decided to upload a very large file in a very crowded neighborhood. What's happening now is that we have so many cable channels, hundreds and hundreds of them, and we also have cable modem internet access, all traveling on this old copper wiring. What's happening is we've pretty much almost reached the bandwidth of this cable's capabilities. And so what's happening now is
fiber.
We're starting to get fiber backbones and fiber infrastructures. And so the cable companies and Verizon and a few others are replacing all this old coax cabling with fiber optic cabling. Instead of the signal being passed along the copper in like a pulse format, in an analog format, you have pulses of light traveling along your fiber optic. Because the speed of light is so fast, we have essentially almost an unlimited amount of capacity and speed on a fiber line.
We went to Verizon's headquarters to find out about their plan to install fiber optic service throughout the city.
Did you ever think that you'd be able to go on to YouTube this morning and catch the late baseball games from last night and see the highlights and whatnot? No, you didn't. Well, think now in 2008. What are the possibilities that could come forward in the year 2015 and 2020? We can't think of them, but what we want to have is a network that's able to handle those things.
Fios is fiber to your home. And it shouldn't be confused with fiber to the node or fiber to the curb. We're actually bringing the fiber I mentioned from the central office directly to your home.
This gets again into these issues of control because Verizon is rolling out fiber, but before they went to the FCC, and because they have a very powerful lobby, they got the rules changed to benefit them again and say, oh, this new fiber, even though we're based on these millions of customers we have from the old telephone system, we don't have to share this new fiber we roll out. They are under no obligation that they have to service everybody. They get to roll it out how they want, when they want, to whom they want. They get to charge what they want. They don't have to share it. It is a private network. We didn't let General Motors build and operate the U.S. highway system. The U.S. highway system benefited GM, just like it benefited Exxon and a lot of other, but anybody doing deliveries, it was there for the public. We have lost the sense of what should be held in common.
We are creating a infrastructure, and it's very key to keep that in mind, the fiber. We're building a network that's supposed to last for another 100 years. So you hear a lot of things like 3D TV and things of that nature, which nowadays really doesn't seem that far off. Well, guess what? Some of the other competitors won't be able to go into those markets without upgrading their infrastructure, but by then it'll be too late. Verizon will already be there.
You know, for the most part, the way that the government is set up, it's to treat that as private property. So it's Verizon's private property, just like if they have they own a building, they get to decide, you know, how to arrange the furniture in the building. That's sort of Verizon's approach to it. But the fact is that when you're talking about a platform that everybody uses, that we share for something as important as speech, then that, I think, gets into a different category as far as our concerns about the wires that Verizon owns.
Some things are almost like state functions. The idea of providing a general purpose communications network, like the idea of providing railroads, seems like something that a sovereign might do, and so it has to be equal and open to everyone. Common carriage is the very simple idea that someone providing essential transport or communications should not be permitted to pick winners and losers among the communications or the bales of hay that it carries. That's the notion, and it was really tied to providers of infrastructure. That infrastructure is so important to society that we should make sure that it's open to all at a fair price without discrimination according to the content of what's being carried. It's the way that telephone companies were required to act with respect to the communications they carried.
The internet basically grew within the phone environment. The infrastructure was just the infrastructure, and sending data over the phone lines, you know, was basically looked at similarly to sending your voice over phone lines. At some point, basically the cable companies, you know, which were providing internet service, went to the FCC and said, hey, look, you know, why does our internet service regulated like it's going over phone lines when it's going over our cable lines?
So Brand X versus FCC is this major landmark case in the summer of 2005 where the cable industry succeeds in persuading the courts that they should not be treated like plain old telephone service providers, that they should be able to be as private as the deli on the corner and not required to be non-discriminatory, not required to open up their facilities to ISPs. It's that case where cable gets that treatment. And then 5 days later, the telephone companies ask for the same treatment for their DSL lines. We've gotten to the situation where our basic transport mechanism is discriminatory, like, you know, a dinner party. And we're not used to having communications treated that way.
Hello? Yeah. I'll be in a party in like 20 minutes. Okay. No aliens? Okay. Sorry, alien. You can't go.
Brouhaha over Comcast that started last fall happened when some people noticed that if they were starting BitTorrent sessions to distribute files, the sessions would just shut down. They couldn't understand why. It turns out that what Comcast was doing was looking for patterns of network use that indicated that BitTorrent was in use, and then sending packets called reset packets, which would say essentially to one part of the conversation in the voice of the other part of the conversation, I need to hang up now. That's what Comcast was doing, and they said they needed to do it because of congestion in their cable lines caused by use of the BitTorrent protocol. I think that's just the tip of the iceberg. All providers of high-speed internet access want the ability to do a lot of deep packet inspection, so they have a lot of information about what's crossing their networks, and then be able to price differentiate perfectly based on what people are doing. It's like the way a cell phone works. You pay differently for different services that you access using your cell phone. They'd like to take that model and apply it to internet use.
What were you thinking? This internet bill is too high. Don't you know every Google search is 15 cents and MySpace is a dollar? And don't get me started on the uploading.
Let's imagine that there were, like the old days, there were thousands of internet service providers. As soon as Comcast starts to block and word gets out about that, then people could take their business across the street to a competitor. But sometimes there's only the cable provider or only the phone company. Sometimes there's neither. So there isn't really a genuine marketplace to take your business across the street.
The problem here is, you just suggested it, two companies, Brooklyn Cablevision, phone company. Bronx Cablevision, phone company. It's not a lot of competition.
We have more competition for bottled water, which is essentially the same, than you have for how to do your connection to the internet, which is basically the foundation of how you're going to do business in the 21st century. It's nuts. It's nuts. The public obligations that had been protected when we first built the telecommunications network by regulation have been removed. And so they've privatized this asset that was built under those protections and shirked the public obligations. And so we got the absolute worst of both worlds, an unregulated monopoly in telecommunications and basically a duopoly in broadband telecommunications. A duopoly, as they said, is a little bit better than a monopoly, but not by much.
I think it goes back to your previous question as to why competition is good. I think if we were a monopoly, or if Cablevision was a monopoly, they could probably charge whatever they wanted until, you know, they got enough noise from their customers that it's too much. So I think Rich made a great point. Competition is definitely driving the price of our services way, way down. I think it's a good thing for everybody.
People have come up with different schemes. There's no easy way to do this.
Municipalities often provide roads to their citizens. They could be providing fiber using their own rights of way and reaching individual houses that way. And they could make it possible for lots of ISPs to light that fiber.
Empire City Subway is actually a great example of an open access system. While they mainly sell to Verizon and they're owned by Verizon, they have to sell on a non-discriminatory basis access to any company that wants to run wires through that. And really the same principle should apply to the wires themselves.
You rent the duct from us, that's like you rent an apartment from the landlord. That's it. You know, who's gonna be living in the apartment? That's none of his business.
One of the problems we have with internet policy is that we can't visualize what the internet is. So I've got a story for you. When Thomas Jefferson wanted to show people in France just how energetic and enormous the United States was, because French people believed that the U.S. was degenerate, essentially, and that nothing could grow large here, he took an enormous moose to France and stuffed it and put it up in someone's parlor just because they could see how enormous and interesting the United States was. So for me, okay, the internet can be a moose.
I would say it would be a gazelle.
Yeah, I'm kind of thinking like a cheetah, you know. It's
whale and cheetah probably do it for me too.
An octopus with a billion legs.
A chameleon.
Be a spider web.
A worm?
Or a beetle?
I was going to say a lamb or something, but the gazelle's a lot faster. An impala. It can't take, it's very timid. It can't take a lot of punishment. Doesn't like water. Doesn't like electric. Doesn't like heat from steam. So it has a lot of enemies that it has to be protected from.
Thank you.